Mr. Gould, we've covered a lot of the topics that I wanted to cover with you, but could we perhaps move on to some of the more personal questions? Tell me, do you believe in the supernatural or in ESP?
You know, no one's ever asked me that before. Do I believe in the supernatural? Of course, yes. And no. That is to say, I don't hold this notion that one's mind can be read like a book or some such thing, but that there are certain inexplicable coincidences in the world seems to me patently obvious.
Have you ever experienced any one of those coincidences? Could you tell me about it?
Yes, several times. The oddest being when I was very young, 9 years old. I should preface this by saying that I've always been fascinated by dreams and the kind of feeling that they leave one with. It's a certain horrible feeling, a tragic sense of loss that one can derive only from a dream. At this time, I was about 9 years old. Pardon me. About 9 years old, and I had this peculiar dream in which I saw myself covered with red spots. The next morning, when I mentioned it to my mother, she'd had exactly the same dream. Now, at that time, there was no hint of measles, no epidemic, no worry of any kind, so the dream certainly couldn't have been affected by any external common suggestion, and yet, 4 days later, I got the measles.
Interesting. Tell me, continuing, what do you believe regarding afterlife?
Well, I was brought up a Presbyterian, though I stopped being a churchgoer at about 18. I've always felt tremendously strongly that there is indeed a hereafter with which we must all reckon, in light of which we must live our lives, and there is that inevitability of the transformation of the spirit. As a consequence, I find all here and now philosophies quite repellent, lax, if you will. I realize, however, that there's a great temptation to formulate a comfortable theory about eternal life so as to reconcile oneself to the inevitability of death. But I like to think that's not what I'm doing. I don't believe I'm trying to create for myself a deliberate self-reassuring process. It just seems intuitively right. I've never had to work very hard at convincing myself of the hereafter. After all, don't you think, it seems infinitely more plausible than its opposite, oblivion.
Hello, Jesse. It's me. I wonder, could you indulge me for a moment? I'm in a bit of a state. Well, I was driving along when I suddenly remembered that story about Schoenberg. Schoenberg. Remember, he was obsessed with numerology, numbers and so forth. So much so that when he turned 65, he was terrified that he was going to die because his age was divisible by 13. So he consulted an astrologer friend who assured him that he would survive until the next time the numbers conspired against him. Well, great, he thought. Another 13 years, I'll be fine till I'm 78. Well, 11 years later, however, when he was 76, the astrologer wrote back to warn him that it's not only numbers that are divisible by 13 that he ought to watch out for, but also those whose digits add up to 13. For example, 76. Needless to say, he was petrified, but not for long. 3 months later, he died, July 13th, 1951. I can't help it. I'm 49 tomorrow, and Schoenberg's still talking to me. Jesse? Jesse, you there?
The week before he died, I remember it in great detail. And it's funny that it's peculiar that I do remember it in such detail, because many of the times our conversations were light and just banter between two good friends. But that week before Glenn died, everything was serious. He couldn't control the birthday that was coming up, the celebration. He seemed to think everything was slipping away from his control. And he was obsessed with this feeling that he wondered, would people recognize him and come to a funeral? And we'd never talked about anything like that before. But he said that he wanted, he would like to be like Huckleberry Finn and come to his own funeral, because he didn't think that there would be people who came. He didn't think that the world loved him like they did. And he knew about how the records were selling. He knew that they were that Japanese people bought a lot of them, that people in Central Europe and in Asia bought a lot of them. But he just didn't think that he was that important. And it never surfaced that, to me at least, that he felt his own fame. His humility was beyond everything. And when I saw the people pour into the St. Paul's Cathedral, I couldn't help but believe, oh, Glenn, you were wrong for probably the first time in your life, you know, because he always liked to think he never was wrong.